I'd like you to look at this picture that Brother Angel is going to show us. A lot of you remember when this was taken, right? This was from our Christmas cantata. And some of you might still remember that I used this slide last time that I spoke to talk about conflicting voices. That we discussed that it's so hard to find the truth in the midst of these conflicting voices. But today I decided to use the same slide and use it for springboard. For two reasons. You know, I've been praying for this message and I know that we will have guests. So I'm taking this opportunity, our beloved guests, to invite you because there's another concert coming. We are going to celebrate Easter in this church on April 16, 9:15 a.m. And this same choir, plus more additions, right? We will be singing again and giving glory to God with our voices. How about that? So, to our guests, please honor us with your presence and let's celebrate Easter together. That's the first reason. The second reason why I show that is because today, I want us to continue our discussion on voices. You know that there is a voice that we need to hear. A voice that tells a story. Our story. See, when God makes something beautiful of your life, don't you want to share it? Don't you want to tell others about it? It is a story worth telling. This morning, we are going to look at a story, a less than ordinary life of a man who has been crippled for 40 years. Guess what? Something good, something beautiful happened in his life. Out of that ordinary life of his, God happened. And he made something beautiful of this man's life. And the beauty of this is, he used this man's story to touch thousands of other lives out of his testimony. Well, the sense of humor, the humor in this story is that out of the 9 gates in the Temple of Jerusalem, our story this morning happened on that gate facing the east. That gate called Beautiful. Join me in prayer, please. Our Father in heaven, may the meditation of my heart and the words of my mouth be pleasing to you. Give me your courage. Give me your boldness as I speak your message. Give me your wisdom, Father, that I may speak only that which you want me to say. And by the power of your Holy Spirit, I want you to touch lives, Father. I beg you to touch lives today. Change lives. In the mighty name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. All right. I want you to stand up and read our text with me. The title of our message is, He Made Something Beautiful of My Life. That is an excerpt, a line from a song called Something Beautiful. That's my dad's favorite. Anyway, our text is found in chapter 3 of Acts, the book of Acts. And we are going to read verses 1 through 12, NIV. May I request the ladies to read the odd number verses, and the men to read the even, and then in verse 12, we'll read it all together. Alright, ready ladies? Let's do it. Now a man whose name from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts.
When he saw fire in the mouth, he asked him,
Peter said, Look at us.
So the man gave them his attention.
than mine, but it will be. I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. Chapter 3 talks about introducing the man. The man who doesn't even have a name in the story, but verses 1 through 5 kind of introduce the man. And from then on, from verse 6 onwards, it was all God's. That was when God happened. And that's the twist in our story. Now, to introduce the man, and to paraphrase verses 1 through 5, I found this cool translation in YouTube. And Engel would play this. I want you to watch this.
Peter and John went to the temple one afternoon to take part in the 3 o'clock prayer service. Okay, wait a second. So this is, I'm going to need you to do something different though. I got this right here. It's actually a version of the Bible that I created. What version are you reading?
This is a New Living Translation.
New Living Translation. Cool. I got the New Hood Translation right here. I'm going to need you to read from the Hood Translation. Some of my boys are probably watching online. Some of them locked up. Yo, glad you got internet in there, man. I need you to read from this translation too, just so they can understand. So you read that translation and then this one so they can understand more clearly. Go ahead. So start with yours.
Okay.
I mean ours, it's not yours. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, good.
Peter and John went to the temple one afternoon to take part in the 3 o'clock prayer service.
Okay, go ahead.
Read that. Pete and John rolled up to the spot about 3 o'clock.
Yeah, so that's what. All right, cool. Keep going. Go ahead.
As they approached the temple, a man lame from birth was being carried in. Each day he was put beside the temple gate, the one called the Beautiful Gate, so he could beg from the people going into the temple.
Cool. Next verse.
A dude with a limp that wasn't a pimp.
Right. He had a limp, but he wasn't a pimp. It was just a natural. I shouldn't have to explain it. So you, go ahead.
I don't think you can say that in church, Mike.
But you just said it, so. That's why I didn't say it. Because Pastor Robert is watching right now. He was tripping, man. I don't know why he's reading this stuff. Go ahead.
A dude with a limp that wasn't a pimp was chilling on the floor.
You have no idea what flow is, do you? We're standing on the flow right now. So,
okay, I'm gonna change this just a little bit. A dude with a limp that wasn't a wimp was chilling on the flow, looking to make some cheddar.
Yeah, exact cheddar. Cheese, money, cash. Come on, man, you got the other version?
I'm just trying to read the Bible, man. That's what I thought I was supposed to be doing.
Yeah, I'm sorry that I made alterations to your expectations right now, but you can just read the
That'd be awesome. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for some money. Peter and John looked at him intently, and Peter said, "Look at us."
All right, go. Do the other version.
So they started mad dogging him.
Like, mad dogging. You know what mad dog is? This dude, I'll show you what mad dog is right now. Look at me.
I don't know what mad dog is.
I'm a mad dog even right now. I'm going to stop talking for a second. All right, go ahead. It's okay. It's okay. You got nervous. I can tell you were scared that I was going to do something. Go ahead.
Continue. I'm trying to get the flow. And you...
It's on the floor, dude.
Okay,
carry on.
So they started mad dogging him, like, "What's up with you, dog?
What is wrong with your leg right now?" Wow, there is a hood anointing falling down right now. Cool. All right, so listen. Why do we do this? Why did I have him come up here and read his other version? Listen, because when he came up here, you know he's a pastor, bona fide, great man of God. Everyone has some expectations. But then I made an alteration to your expectations, and then we all laughed, which was a revelation. It's evidence of a revelation. So now he's going to read it for just read for the other version.
Michael Jr. used the word alteration to indicate a switch, a change, a shift, a transition from this man's story to our story this morning, God's story. It started with a regular story of a man begging at the temple, and then the switch. Michael Jr., in fact, if you watch that at YouTube, emphasized in the King James Version the two mentions of the word but to indicate this change, this transition. NIV would have the single word but just the same, it transitioned to something beautiful. Verse 6, it says, Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but what I have I give unto thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." There is power in the name of Jesus. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
I want you to do something for me this morning. I want you to look at the person next to you, and in a very convincing and meaningful manner, I want you to say that statement. There is power in the name of Jesus. Can you do that? One, two, ready? Go. Thank you. Thank you. That was powerful. I could hear it from here. That means that was powerful. You know, I ask you to do that because sometimes a lot of us, the best of us, needs to be reminded of that fact that there is power in the name of Jesus. Remember that time when you were praying for healing? Or when you were praying for somebody else, a friend of yours, and you are praying for her to get better, and then she texts you and say, "Cancer cells are down." By whose name was that prayer answered? The name of Jesus, right? Remember that time you were looking for a job. You were struggling so hard to make both ends meet. Your finances are in shambles, and you don't know what to do. You're confused, you're struggling. And you pray and pray and pray and pray some more until your tears have dried up. And then God answered. By whose name was that prayer answered? There is power in the name of Jesus. We need to say that right now because some of you here are going through a struggle, a crisis. There is no better encouragement and no better hope than to hear this, like what Peter said to the man. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. There is power in the name of Jesus. I tell you this morning, let's look at the three things that happened by the mention of that name. Let's look at one. Healing happened. You know, to add to that verse, in verse 12 of chapter 4, it says here, salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. In verse 16 of chapter 3, it says, by faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. Healing happened. You know how hard this is? This is impossible. In verse 7, it says, instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. That is impossible. You can ask Sister Virai about it. She's a physical therapist. Last Friday, during prayer meeting, I had an opportunity to ask her the main purpose of physical therapists. And she told me that it is to nurse the muscles of the person back to health so that the person can perform normal function. If this is the kind of healing that hospitals and doctors are giving us, then Sister Virai will be out of job, right? Now, instantly, the legs became strong. You know, I had a similar experience when I was 8 years old. I had a bone tumor on my right hip. That's why sometimes my friends could still see me walk with a limp, right? Because I had a surgery when I was young. And after the surgery, they had to put a plaster cast on my 1.5 legs. The whole right leg and then half of the left leg, and then they put a wood right in between so that the legs won't touch each other, I guess. And I was little, so I don't really know how long I had the plaster cast. But when they finally removed it, you know, the thinking of a little kid, right, that I could just jump back on my feet and play, I did that, but I fell down because there's no legs underneath. It took some time, I don't know how long, before the legs finally got stronger. As I was talking again, continuing my talk with Sister Virai, she said that back then, these are 70s, 1972 or 71, 69 actually. 1969, this was 1969. There were not a lot of physical therapies back then. So what my dad did, you know, to get me on my feet, he pulled out a 20 peso bill, right? 20 peso, and then stood right 5 feet in front of me and said, come and get it. Of course I tried, but I failed. After a step or two, I fell down. It took a while, and it took my uncle, who's not even a physical therapist, he was a banker. This time he pulled a 1,000 peso bill, and he stood 10 feet away from me, and said, before he can say, get it, he said, come. I threw my crutches away, and I flew and took that 1,000 peso bill, and I was healed. I was walking again. So I was telling Sister Villa, maybe that's good. Strategy for PDs, right? 1,000 pesos. All right, anyway, so just to describe, it is impossible. In verse 16 of chapter 4, let's read that. Because all the people were praising God for what happened, for the man was miraculously healed, and he was over 40 years old. Can you imagine? 40 years old without walking. He doesn't have any idea how to run the marathon or do a prayer walk. That's another advertisement. Come last Saturday of May, we are sponsoring a prayer walk, right? So I invite you to do that. He hasn't known how to walk. And suddenly for 40 years. And my question is, why 40 years? Why took too long? Because of this message that God is going to do. God works in His time, not on our time. See, Sister Rose spoke about that. Those who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength, will soar on wings like eagle, will run and not get weary, will walk and not faint. It is those who wait upon the Lord. And this man waited and waited and waited. It took 40 years. before Peter finally saw him and the opportunity came to be touched by the Master Potter. He made something beautiful of this life, all right? After 40 years, because it's God's time, not ours. The second thing that happened, and this is really, really important, transformation happened. I want you to look at verse 8. He began to walk. He went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. You know that in verse, again, I keep coming back to chapter 3, verse 16, and chapter 4, verse 20, 21 and 22. Because in chapter 3, verse 16, it said, it is this man's faith that has made him whole. He believed that there is power in the name of Jesus. And guess what? He was not only healed, his life was changed. 2 Corinthians 5:17. What does it say? Any man who is in Christ is a new creation. The man didn't go back. Oh, wait. How I can walk again? Let me go tell my friends. Let me partay. He didn't do that. He didn't go back home and clean up first. And then I'll go back later. No. Because that man was dead. That man was crucified with Christ. Galatians 2:20. I'm crucified with Christ. It's no longer I that lives, but Christ that lives in me. The life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself to me, for me, gave his life for me, and died for me. This man was changed. He was no longer the same man. He turned around, metanoia, not repentir, right? When the word repent is used for salvation, it is not I'm sorry. It is metanoia, the changing of the mind. This man's whole life was changed. His mind was transformed. He's no longer conformed with the ways of the Lord. As Paul said in Romans 12:2, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And that's what happened in here. A transformation happened. He started walking with them towards the temple. When God touched you, you must understand that it's God. That's the first thing. Because God puts his signature on it. When I was touched by God, you know, I'm a pastor's kid. And I'm always known. I grew up in Sunday school, grew up in my father's teaching, but see, I haven't felt that touch until 2006. God told me, Manny, you are never going to live the same way again. I was attending a small group with Brother Manny here, and God used that small group to give my life purpose. God touched me and healed me from a habit that has been enslaving me. And I knew it was God because he put his signature on it. And I was transformed, I tell you. I turned around and I followed my Jesus. This man believed, and by that faith, there is no other name that can save us except that mighty name. Transformation happened. And what do you do when God changed you? That brings us to number three. Testimony happens. You know, the definition of a testimony is an open acknowledgement. Like, there was this soldier who was wounded in a battle, in a war. War zone, his company got ambushed. And he was attended to by a medic. This medic nursed him back to health, and just before he boarded the chopper that would take him to base camp, he asked for the man's name. He said, what is your name? And the medic said, that's not important right now. The more important thing is to get you to the camp and get some blood and nurse you back to health. said, I know that is important. I have to know your name. You know why? When I go back home, when I get healthy, when they send me back to my family, I want to tell my family, my children, my wife, my friends, the name of the person who saved me. Amen? Amen. Who saved you? By whose name was your life changed? Power of that name. And then a testimony happened. When all the people saw him walking and praising God. You see, this man could have walked quietly, you know. Oh, I'm changed. I can walk again. Let me follow these guys to the temple. No, he didn't. Oh, I'm changed and well again. Let me quietly walk with them so as not to get attention. There is a song. You want the whole, I want the world to know. That's an old song. I want the world to know the Lord above has come to me. I want to pass it on. I want the whole world to know who saved me. And this guy, he was jumping, right? Right to get attention. He didn't walk, he jumped. He was praising God on top of his voice, I would assume. Why? Because it attracted the crowd. And because of that testimony, guys, that is a very important piece. Because your story is not yours. Your story is his. In your place of work, don't hide your testimony. Tell people that you are a Christian. It's tough, I know. It's tough to start a testimony at school, at work. It's tough because that testimony will be challenged. But we have to share that story because it is not ours. It's God's story. What happened? Out of the man's life, God used that story for Peter to find an opportunity. Dr. Henry Blackaby, in his book, Experiencing God, speaks about how God is always at work around us. And he gives us an invitation every time. You know that invitation, what that invitation is? To join him in what he's doing. Now, some people think that if you don't act in church, the work of the Lord will stop, the kingdom will stop and wait for you. No, sir. The kingdom goes on. And you will miss that opportunity to join God in his mighty work. It is an opportunity, a privilege for us Christians to see where God is working and to jump in. I mean, Lord, use me, I'm here. Right? Because he is always at work. And Peter saw that opportunity. He jumped in. While the man held on to Peter and John, when Peter saw this, I want you to look at verse 12. When Peter saw this, he said to them, fellow Israelites. That is the beginning of this message. Fellow Israelites, you think out of my holiness, out of John and mine's holiness and power, we have healed the man? No way! You know who healed this man? It was him whom you crucified on the cross. Peter spoke boldly and preached to thousands of people. Why do I know it's thousands? You will find that as you read chapter 4. The numbers of the church grew from 3,000 to 5,000. Well, how about that? That is Peter's second biggest congregation today. The first one was the Pentecost. The second one was this. He preached to thousands of people and thousands of lives were saved. Why? Because he saw the opportunity and he jumped in. Out of the man's testimony. The second thing, there are three things that resulted from Peter's preaching. And I mentioned the first one already. 2,000 lives were changed. About 2,000 lives were changed. But many who heard the message believed. So the number grew. That's chapter 4, verse 4. The number grew to about 5,000. Again, we say, salvation is found in no other name, in no other person, except the man Jesus. Second thing that resulted from it, let's look at that. It disturbed the skeptics and the hypocrites. You know, when the leaders of the church, mostly Sadducees, you know, the Sadducees, they don't believe in the resurrection of the dead. So when they saw this, they were greatly disturbed that Peter was preaching about the man who was crucified. That man didn't come back to life. That man can't come back to life. And there is no power in that name. So they pulled Peter out. They put him to jail for one night because offices are closed, right? By 4, offices are closed. You stay there in jail. And then the following day, they put him in trial. They grilled him. But see, they almost got saved. I really believe that they were really disturbed. Look at the words here. I'd like to say that there are words here that I thought was interesting. Let me use my hard copy. Thank goodness. I have the hard copy because my technology here, it stopped from working as soon as I opened it. So let me just look at a few words on this. They were greatly disturbed, they were astonished, and they took notes. These people, they knew something's going on, and there was nothing they could say. You see, a lot of us, we don't want to share our testimony in our place of work. You know why? Because of the skeptics and the hypocrites. Because you know there are people, once you introduce yourself as Christian, and this is true to all of us, I'm pretty sure, they will watch your life. And when they find something wrong, guess what? Aha! You say you're a Christian, right? Look at you. You're not better than... Do you believe that? That one should declare one thing that prevents us from declaring our faith in our place of work is the fear that people would talk about us. Fear that people would put us in a microscope or a what's that? The magnifying glass and check if there's anything wrong in us. And then out of that one speck, we'll make a whole case. A case against the man, the name whom we represent. Have you had that feeling? Oh, that is a very sound, legitimate, real feeling. What if they say, are you're a Christian and you yell at your students that Miss Wilson is right across my classroom. And when I raise my voice, I like to use political correctness here. When I raise my voice a little bit, Miss Wilson would come at the door and close her classroom door, right? But I love my students. Believe me, I do. Every morning, I pray with my partner. He could not make it today because he had severe sinusitis. He preached last night. I pray with my partner. I pray for the whole day, right? I pray for the whole day. Lord, teach us how to teach. Give us a heart that love and give these students success today. And there are some students who would stand beside us and would say amen. In the morning. And by noon, I was already on top of my voice and say, sit down, do your work. And then I remember when I see Miss Wilson, I see Miss Wilson, I see Miss Fleshman across the, about three rooms down, and I say, better not. You know, my point on that is, if you declare your faith, there are other Christians who will be with you. They will look at you, and you will be reminded whom you represent. Hello, Mr. Ronnie. We're Christians here. That is an accountability, a responsibility. We encourage one another, Proverbs 27:17, as iron sharpens iron, a brother sharpens another. Amen? We got each other's back. You find that in the place of work. I found mine. I got my friend's place of work. Miss Henderson, every morning when I see her, I know I'm right. Good morning, Miss Henderson. It's going to be a great week. Right? I know. Because there is power in the name, there is power in the story, and we have to carry it in a place of work. We are accountable for that story. Well, some of us have already started that story in our place of work, but it ain't pretty. Some of us have started on the wrong foot, right? Come on, they don't know me as a Christian in my place of work. Because one time I did this and I made a mistake. And if I tell them that I'm a Christian, I would be embarrassing my Lord. I tell you this, brother. I tell you this, sister. Try God. Pray. Lord, give me a fresh start. I want to declare you in my school, in my place of work, to my friends. I want them to know that I'm a Christian. And give me people who will remind me every day that I am a Christian. So it disturbed the skeptics, but it shut them up too. At the last part of this verse, they couldn't say nothing because they could see the lame person walking. God will shut them up. God will protect His name and will get His glory through your story. And then the last result of that would be, it spurred the believers to speak out. You know, when they let Peter go, they tried to tell Peter. Of course, that's the best they could do. Shh, don't preach about that Jesus again. Don't be talking about that Jesus again. Peter said, how can I? How can I not? How can I not? You cannot shut my mouth because I cannot keep it quiet because the Lord above has come to me and I want to pass it on. So He came and showed Himself to the other believers and they all prayed. They all prayed. Look, now Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name, of your holy servant Jesus. Again, we go back to the power of that name, and that name had enabled the servants to speak boldly. Look at verse 31 of chapter 4. It says, after they prayed, the place where they were meeting was what? Read your Bible. It was shaken. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and they spoke word of God boldly. Boldly. Now you don't have to be smart. That's what the Sadducees is saying. Aren't these common people? Aren't these fishermen? These are the people who follow Jesus. You don't need your words. God supplies the word. The word of God is here. And your Sunday school teachers will enable and equip you to the works of service. Amen. The only thing is you have to read your Bible. You have to attend your Sunday school, guys, right? Because the Sunday school teachers, the teachers that we help, their purpose is to equip us for the works of service. How do we share God's love? Find a church, belong to a community of believers, and share that love that God has given you. Share that love that God has given you. We're studying 1 Peter in Sunday school. In 1 Peter 2, 2, crave for the pure spiritual milk, which is the Word of God. Crave, like newborn babes. Crave for the pure spiritual milk. And then, go out there and speak boldly to your friends, to your family first. Don't forget your family, guys. Really important. Right? Really important. Then to your friends. This morning, it's 10:35. This morning, I am compelled to ask you three things. You know this aisle right here? One purpose of this aisle is for the kids to pray. Right? For the kids, where the kids can pray. Come up front. Today, I would like to use this aisle for us to pray. For our guests, it is with pride that I tell you, this church is a praying church. I've seen churches when prayer is failing. But when people of God come together, right, and pray, it's pleasing to God. Right now, I will ask you to stand up. And I want you to commit through prayer. There are three petitions that I'd like you to think about. And I want us to empty those seats and come up front. Because we will take it at the foot of the cross and we will pray as we are strong in prayers. One, if you don't have that story, if you don't have a story to tell, you don't have that relationship with us, with our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you want to say, Lord, I'm done running my own life. I'm tired. I'm losing this battle every day to sin in the world. I'm messed up. I'm a sinner who want to be saved. I want my Lord Jesus to come to me and be my Savior and be my Lord. I want you to come as I invite you. The second story, the second petition that I'd like to invite today, I'd like you to consider today, is if you have a story, sister, if you have a story, brother, and you haven't started telling that story in your place of work, in your school, I want you to stand up. I want you to commit right now in prayer and tell God, Father, I want to make a difference. I want to join you in what you're doing in my school, and I want to tell my friends about your story. But give me courage. Protect me from the skeptics and give me courage. For it is only through your wisdom and your courage and your confidence that I can. By the power of that name, I invite you, brothers and sisters, if you want to commit to sharing and telling that story to your friends, in your place of work, in school, wherever you are, every opportunity where God is working, I invite you to come. And then the third, if you are in a story right now, God is making something beautiful of your life right now. If you're in crisis, if you're having trouble, if you're struggling right now, whatever it is, job, finances, relationships, habits, vices, or whatever that you are being troubled with, I beg you, let us all come. Let us stand right now as we end in prayer. Let us fill this front with people who would like to share their story. Can we do that right now? Can we help? 2 minutes of response, and then we will end in prayer. as people are coming to the front, I'd like to start praying. Father, it is good to be on our feet and listen to you as you call us to challenge us to tell our story. Father, there are three petitions, but only one purpose. Purpose is to give you glory. It is not our story. It is yours. Whatever we're going through, you know, you understand. You told us to be still and know that you are God. You told us that you have plans for us, plans to prosper us. You told us that you are going to give us life in heaven abundantly. Father, we have a story. And if we don't, Father, we pray for our friends who don't have one. We pray, but in the name, in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus, you come and fill their void heart. That they may see our Lord Jesus as their Savior and Lord. If we don't see courage in us to tell the story, Father, we pray in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus that we be emboldened, that we may find courage, that through us our place of work may be blessed, that through us our classrooms may be blessed, our school may be blessed, our friends may be blessed as well. Because this is not our story, Father. It is your story in the name of Jesus. And finally, Father, we come to you as we struggle. We rejoice in our struggle right now because we know that if we wait upon you, you are going to do something about it, something beautiful in our lives. Your signature will be all over it. And we will declare your goodness, your kindness, and give you glory with our life. Because God has made a story, and I'm going to tell it. I'm going to tell it to my friends. Because in the mighty name of Jesus, you're going to finish that story. And you're going to give us testimony. All glory be yours, Father. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.